Okay, welcome back to CE 120B, 220B, Session 8. Today, we're going to continue talking about the building envelope and kind of be slowly migrating our way towards talking about the structure which is inside that envelope. Today, I just want to talk about just a very few little pickup items, I'll call them, about daylighting, because the daylighting to analysis tool is not only very powerful, it's also sort of very finicky, and some of its functionality is sort of hidden away behind some menu choices you might not suspect. But it's really quite powerful. We've been doing a lot of playing around with it relative to not only what we're trying to do with daylighting here, but also trying to think about doing analysis of internal light. And there's really quite a bit of functionality built into this little plugin. So we'll spend a little time looking at that. Most of today, at least at the beginning, we're going to talk about the building envelope and specifically be thinking about kind of the thermal properties as opposed to the daylighting properties, kind of the other side of what you're often trying to accomplish with your building envelope design. And then towards the latter part of today, we want to start moving into sort of the structural framing, sort of thinking of the structural framework that's inside your building. And we'll think about sort of different strategies for how the envelope and the structure might relate to each other, typically depending on the type of material and construction technology you're using. But there's a lot of different ways to approach this, so you should sort of know about all the different things you have available to you. Okay. Relative to the design project, again, this is the week. A lot of people have been spending their time looking at the building envelope and the overall kind of layout. Really, as we're checking with people on check-in 2, and as you start thinking about moving towards check-in 3, which will be next week, the thing to be focusing on is you really start wanting to have just that, oh, I'll call it like the preliminary design of it to be fairly complete, to be locked down. You want to sort of know where the big spaces are going to be, what the basic relationship between the spaces is going to be, because as we start layering in different types of building systems, be it the structure or the mechanical systems, it's helpful to have the big spaces, I won't say locked down exactly, but at least not moving around radically at that point, so you're not doing a lot of rework. So, really see if you can sort of firm up your design concepts and kind of get them feeling just fairly firm. You can still be tweaking things if the elements of the building envelope keep on changing relative to those locations. That's all cool. But if the auditorium's on the left side of the building in the front, then it should probably stay there. Otherwise, you're going to be doing a lot of rework in terms of trying to keep up with your architectural design. So really try to bang that through. Okay. The other activity that's kind of floating around right now is relative to the little exercises, the unit exercises to sort of practice some things. Again, there's an exercise 2 out there, which is a very simple kind of L-shaped building where your goal there is really just to sort of play around with the envelope and just try some different wall surfaces, some different window treatments. Again, no right or wrong answer, but you're going to kind of come up with a design and sort of a rationale for why you did it that way. And yeah, you know, again, there's no right or wrong. It's just sort of if you have reasoning, go ahead and show how your design supports your reasoning. That's what you're trying to accomplish. Okay, thinking about the building envelope and the pieces of the building envelope. Let me go ahead and kind of pop that down. We talked about last time it being all about balancing a different series of goals and trying to come up with a layered strategy. It really starts to think about all these different things and sort of how they work together as sort of a hierarchy or as a series of design decisions that build upon each other. So starting typically with the overall massing and then thinking about things like just how the sun's affecting the building, how you might be optimizing, for the daylighting versus the thermal performance relative to the sun. But also thinking about how shading is happening relative to the outdoor spaces, sort of working with a lot of these elements, because the sun's probably the most dominant force. But as many of you are starting to explore in your own sort of designs, how wind factors in there, if you have sort of prevailing winds that you're trying to capitalize on for some natural ventilation or for a cooling effect off of a lake or something, how that can sort of factor in there in terms of how you site the building. But it tends to be sort of based on an overall strategy, a hierarchy that works its way down to finer and finer decisions. So I definitely sort of advocate kind of top down how you want to think about it. And then starting to articulate it in your design elements. Okay. In terms of the tools, what we've been looking at here is, last time we spent a lot of time kind of looking at daylighting analysis. different aspects of daylighting analysis. And there are some different daylighting test cases. Let me just go ahead and kind of point those out to you again, sort of based upon what you're trying to illustrate. In the daylighting test cases, which are a bunch of Revit files that are out there, you'll find everything for what I'll call typical view windows, where you're putting things in kind of at eye level, because you want to not only have daylighting, but you're also trying to encourage a view, both with minimal and deep overhangs, depending on how the roof overhang is working. We have sort of the notion of clear story windows, those windows at the top above the view plane, just there to kind of let light in at the higher levels. Curtain walls, and in terms of curtain walls, thinking about light shading, whether we put shelves in to go ahead and kind of block some of the light, whether it's a single shelf or multiple shelves, or even this more of an, what I call a freestanding screen, a brise-soleil. I did that actually in the recording from last session. Maybe I should sort of pick up with that here. But the idea is that we can go through and have elements which are not built right into the facade, but actually standing away from the facade, almost freestanding walls that don't necessarily have to have glazing in them, but they're just a series of different shading elements. So, we also have something in here about, you know, different ways to approach top lighting, whether we have skylights, a shed skylight, a light slot. There's a lot of different sort of ways to look at that. And ultimately, you'll probably come up with a combination of different ways. But just to sort of illustrate what's going on there, if you go out to those examples in session 7, and you go to the daylighting sample buildings, I think I was showing this one in terms of like the shed skylight, which we have a lot of around here. I'll do it. Last time I opened up the one that had the glass walls, I'll open the one that has the opaque walls. But we'll just go ahead and take a look. There's just all these different little road models that sort of illustrate these different types of conditions. So this is what I call more of a shed skylight that has solid walls. It's kind of interesting, for all these different ones, we can start to analyze them in more detail in terms of understanding why they have different sort of performance properties that make them better. If I go back to the one with glass walls, you'll sort of see, this is more the idea that it has glass on all sides. But let's talk about what the advantage and disadvantage of both of those are, because it's sometimes a little bit counterintuitive. I look at something like this and it seems to have glass on all sides, kind of pointing to the slot in the roof, and that would almost sort of seem to let in an awful lot of light. That sort of sounds sort of good. If I go through and take a look at this one instead, I have solid walls around the outside. Okay, so how's this? Where's your intuition? Think about, like, which one of those do you think actually does a better job of getting light down into the inside of the building? And think about why you think about that having that effect. So, any kind of general votes in terms of which one you think would be better? Who thinks the glass on all sides would be better about getting light into the building? Anyone? Okay, I got 2, 3. Anyone for the solid wall one? Okay, now, as the lone standout, not to put you on the spot here, why do you think, what's your intuition telling you about why that might be a good design?
I don't know, I think the light could bounce off the room, having the glass
You are absolutely correct in your thinking. So it's often sort of counterintuitive, but let's kind of go back to the original and kind of think about how it works and why sometimes unusual results can be sort of proven out. The glass wall skylight's kind of really good from the standpoint that lets in light from all sides. Basically, daylighting comes from all sides. It's omnidirectional. Sunlight comes from wherever the angle of the sun is. And the two sort of add together to give you light inside the space. This sort of strategy is good for daylighting in that it gets light from all sides. So the northern windows are kind of good. If those are northern windows at the kind of tall side, it lets light in. It ultimately can kind of get down to that slot, but it ultimately has to get down through that slot to get into the building. Okay. What happens in this other strategy, which is actually sort of very cool, is as you're thinking about skylighting and trying to get light down into a building, it turns out it's very, very helpful to have reflecting surfaces, walls that basically light can reflect off of. So what happens in this sort of scenario is, let me go ahead and open up my little ink tool. get it over there, and I'm here. Clear all that, get you out of the way. Can I get my little ink tool going over here? Okay, so in this sort of scenario, what often happens is, especially on the southern side, light comes in, some of it's going to go ahead and miss, some is going to come in and actually hit that and bounce back in and bounce into the hole. So there's this notion of basically reflecting. And one of the most strong things you can do in terms of thinking about daylighting is finding ways to basically reflect the light in. Right around the windows, right around the openings, you get a lot of direct light there. But if you can find ways to bounce it and get it kind of to fill the rest of the space, then you're in much better shape in terms of filling out the entire space. So, for example, let me get a zoom on out here. My little zoom to fit. I've got my little building here. It's kind of looking good. Let me go through and just I'll put a little curtain wall here on the front of it. Not modify my roof. I'll just go ahead and kind of cut this all the way back over here. A little curtain wall action at the front. There's a certain amount of light that's going to come on in just based on the fact that it can get through that front window and it's going to hit the floor. Okay, so if we were thinking about trying to get the light back further into the space, further than the direct light coming in and hitting that floor, and we had the choice of a beautiful, dark gray rug, the ultimate in kind of ultra modern, kind of chic, but a nice gray rug, kind of, you know, silvery gray, something like that. Versus, some plain old boring concrete that's all polished and kind of relatively white in color. Yeah. Which do you think would do a better job of getting the light back into the building?
The white.
Yeah. It's very much related to kind of color theory. White reflects an awful lot of light. So if you're trying to reflect light, put light colors. If you're trying to absorb light, put dark colors. And we'll do these things where we'll have this fantastic daylighting strategy all worked out, and then someone will come in and put a rug all over the whole place because it somehow felt better, and it really defeats the purpose of going through and getting the light in there. That rug might also sort of defeat the purpose if I was trying to use that concrete surface as a thermal mass and I was trying to absorb a lot of heat throughout the day that would re-radiate through the night. Putting that rug in might make their toes feel really nice while you're there during the day, but it's keeping the concrete from absorbing the radiation, so it won't be available to be used later on as a battery. So in this building, this very building we're in, there was quite a contentious battle when we all first moved in about people who started putting rugs on top of their concrete floor, and whether that was going to defeat the purpose of a lot of the good or thermal planning. But watch out for that. Daylighting and bouncing surfaces is kind of a really kind of important way of looking at it. Even as you think about, let me kind of show you this. Go ahead, Henry, what you think? Were you asking?
So in terms of the whether it's light or dark for the floor, does it only matter near the perimeter?
It's really wherever you're counting on it to reflect. So if once you're beyond the boundary of where the sunlight's coming in, then thermally it wouldn't matter if the sunlight isn't hitting it. Daylight is sort of a very interesting thing, because even if we have daylight coming in and it hits this fantastic floor, then it bounces up to the white ceiling, it'll continue to bounce. It'll bounce, 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 bounce. So you could actually bounce quite far. It gets a little more diffused the further back you go. But even if you're sort of playing around with your daylighting analysis, if you're getting these very bad results and you want to sort of amp it up a little bit, try painting the walls. Because if you just sort of paint them a light color, it'll actually sort of give you a better result. Okay, so the wall reflectance is one of those things. Reflectance and daylighting also kind of factors into things like this. If I go through and let me draw the little section box here. So in this sort of scenario, see what I did? Oops, moving the floor, not the wall. Not the section box, hang on. I keep moving the floor. Okay, in this scenario, you will see those skylights are kind of in the center of the room, which sounds like such a sensible thing to do. Put the skylight in the center of the room. Who wouldn't want the light in the center of the room? The problem is light comes in and hits the center of the room, it kind of comes through that little slot, illuminates the part that's right underneath it, but there's not a whole lot of surface to necessarily bounce on, especially if there's a lot of desks and clutter and things that aren't giving you nice reflective surfaces. So this will sound really counterintuitive, but sometimes you'll get a much better result. Let's see if I can find my little blue, there it is, by doing this. If I just take that skylight and move it over towards the wall. Now, do this relative to the way the sun is shining. Well, it'll work for any daylight, but especially sunlight. What's going to happen now is the sunlight's actually going to come in and it'll probably hit that wall on the other side. And in the same sense as my white floor, if I have a beautiful white wall, it'll reflect off. If it's painted black, it's not going to do such a good job. Interesting thing. Okay, this is very counterintuitive. What if I mirrored that wall? Do mirrors reflect light? That may be true. Mirrors is very counterintuitive thing. We love mirrors because they make everything look bigger and the light that's behind you is reflected in the mirror, so everything looks bright. But a funny thing is, try this sometime with your, at home with your flashlight in front of the bathroom mirror. They're really, really bad at reflecting light. So sort of mirrors almost suck up all the light. It's a really kind of a very strange thing. Play around with it. You'll sort of see the best thing is actually, we get all clever. Oh, I'll put a mirrored surface in there. And it sort of defeats, I made this mistake architecturally once. Yeah. Bright white is actually the best way because it reflects all color as opposed to sort of sucking it up. So, lots of things to play with daylighting. In terms of some gotchas, this is what I want to sort of warn you about in terms of using the tool. Oh, the question came up of how much daylighting do you want? Really, what is the threshold that you want? And I keep on promising that I'll look that up for you. So I was, as we were meeting with Gustavo yesterday, encouraged to try looking that up. And let's see if we can find it right now. So lead daylighting point requirements. It's actually a little more complicated, which is why it's a little bit different. I think it used to be like 80% overall, but it's changed a little bit now. Let me see if I can find the table. Hang on. Let's go up there. That's 2013. Well, that might still have it. Yada, yada, yada. That's not the table. I'll find the table out here, but basically what we found as we were looking at it online is that there were two different levels that you could try to achieve. And the way it works now is actually there's like two different thresholds. If you go ahead and you can achieve, and I believe when we looked it up yesterday, yada, 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 not in there. It looks like the old. This is what we used to get. For a minimum of 75% or more, you have to like go through and like, it used to be like 75%, it was 80. Now it's basically, it's either 70% or 90%. If you go through and achieve like a 70% level of like adequate daylighting between the 300 and the 3000 lumens, you're gonna get 2 points. If you can actually sort of get 90% of the area to qualify, you get 3 points. So it's kind of a little bit of a sliding scale to encourage you to be extra good. Kind of sad, 50% doesn't get you much of anything. There's no 1 point option, as best I can tell. Okay, so there's certain levels, but again, that's not to say that those are the end all in terms of your guidelines. If you get 50%, super, it's better than being dark or something like that. You just won't get lead daylighting requirements. So yeah, that's a specific set of requirements, and if you're shooting for that, super. But in general, just trying to raise the daylighting level is contributing to helping you reduce the energy load and really make it a much more pleasant space. We tend to enjoy being in daylight much more than in the artificial lighting. As you think about using the little daylighting tool that is built into Revit, here are a couple of tips and gotchas to watch out for. Okay, as you use it, it really depends on there being floors in the spaces where you're doing the analysis. So if you don't have a floor, it won't understand that it should be doing the analysis and create the grid there. So there has to be a floor there. And there also has to be a room there. And even more so, or even compounding it one step further, the base of the room has to be at the floor level. Okay, so a couple of different things to watch out for. If on your underground spaces you put a pad in, because a pad makes perfect sense for removing some of the dirt, okay, that won't register as a floor. You'll need to put a floor on top of the pad, and then it'll get it. So if you have a basement and you're not seeing any results, okay, check to see how a floor, and make sure the floor is above the pad. Okay. Also make sure the floor is at the same level as the floor level. And if it isn't, if you're gonna have a floor that's raised, 2 feet off or something like that, put another level in, because it'll only go through and do the calculation and give you the grid when it finds a floor at the floor level. Okay, so any offset you have to mess around. And occasionally in stairways that are cutting up in half heights, you end up with these odd conditions where it's hard to do the analysis. You just have to sort of mess around with the floors and the levels. Okay. In terms of the lighting scheme, let's look at that. Actually, let me even open up the one that I did yesterday and kind of look at this. Let's see if I can find it here. I know where we did. Well, we can look it up there. Let me go up to my downloads. Oh, it's not going to do that to me. It will. Okay. This is an example we were working on for the other class to kind of think about interior lighting, but the same sort of principles will apply for us here. Basically, as you go through and you create daylighting, okay, as you go through and do that, Revit always, or this plugin, creates a couple different views for it. It's called the Lighting Analysis Level Plan. It also goes through and creates this Lighting Analysis Model View. Okay, so if you want to go through and start changing around some of the criteria that it's going to use for the analysis, okay, this is actually where you do it. You do it in this view, and anything you set in this view will ultimately determine what is subdivided in each of the different floor levels and kind of generated there. So if, for example, you have a specific design option that you want to use, you'd set it in this view. If you have a specific phase you want it to go for, you'd go for this view. Okay, so watch out for some of those things. Let me come back over here. This 3D lighting analysis view turns out to be really important. And one of the ways that it turns out to be important is, in that lighting analysis view, there's something called rendering settings. So if you want to do an analysis that is not of the sunlight, which would typically be interior sun only, if you prefer to do one that has sun and a combination of artificial lights, okay, then this will actually take into account not only the sunlight at their prescribed times, but also the artificial lights. That wouldn't qualify for LEED, but it is still useful information for you just in planning out your lighting scheme for how you're laying out the lights in the buildings. Or if you go to artificial only, that would be good for thinking about the nighttime condition, or if you had only artificial lights, you could still go through and do these same sorts of calculations and really see exactly what the luminance levels are at all the different spaces and really sort of see how good a job you've done of laying out all the different lights. Okay. Which, of course, Henry wants to go through and compute into a lighting power density. Henry, ask your question.
So when you consider sunlight and artificial light,
yes,
and you choose a specific time, mm-hmm, day of time,
mm-hmm,
is the amount of artificial light being modeled the same as what you put in your lighting light intensity.
Exactly. Well, no, it's not actually related. You wish it would be related to this whole notion of the lighting power density. It's not that connected, although that's the part I keep encouraging you to write the plugin to do. It's really, what it's doing is you have a series of different artificial lights that are in here on the ceiling. And for these artificial lights, which are hanging here on the ceiling, okay, we have a type to them. They have different data about kind of how many watts they are. They have a IES file, which is a photometric profile. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that shows the spread of the light out from that surface. So it'll use this data, but it still isn't going through and computing the lighting power density for you. So it's basing it on this.
But for a certain time, because sometimes you have sensors, how do you know if it's on and off?
It doesn't actually sort of give you very much data for. What you can do, it doesn't have automatic sensing, although this would actually be a really interesting sort of Dynamo script to write for anyone who's sort of interested in that. It's one of those, you could write something based upon the sun coming in, adjust the dimming on all the different lights. Where the dimming shows up is in these rendering settings. See if I can go back out to the view. If I go to the rendering settings under artificial lights, you can set a value of 0 to 1 for each of the lights, which will be everything from completely off to fully on. 0.5 would be 50%.
Is that like with a time schedule?
No, that's just sort of a static thing. So what we'd almost want to do, here would be a really good system. You'd like to say, for the specific time, figure out where the sun is, then we'll figure out like how much light we think is coming in from the sun, then let's go ahead and adjust the dimming to kind of fill in the rest to the desired level, and then based on that and that level, we'd like to take all those numbers and compute the lighting power density. Okay, but that isn't the way it works right now. But theoretically or logically, that's the way you should think about it. In terms of there's a hierarchy, yeah, that's how it comes.
So when you run the sunlight artificial, it assumes it's on?
Assumes it's on. Well, if that says 1, it assumes it's on.
Oh, and is this on a per family or?
This is on a light by light basis.
Oh, like per instance.
Yeah, per instance.
Oh, okay.
We can group them and turn on and off entire groups, but it's per light.
Oh, okay. So basically, if you want to try out during the daytime and during nighttime, you can run two separate.
Yes.
Have a dimming and have no dimming.
Yeah. Exactly.
Oh, okay.
You can kind of set different kind of states. But that whole dynamic system, which is the thing that I always love so much, if we could really have the model the lighting sensors so that the lighting sensors were adjusting the dimming to the level necessary to bring the light back up to the desired number of lumens, that'd be more interesting.
Thank you.
No worries. Oh, yeah, good question. Okay, so daylighting, just those are the general things about it. Oh, one other thing to kind of think about that has an effect, and I think this may have an effect on the whole tree question, is this whole issue of permanent or non-permanent elements. We sort of got into this because in terms of Gustavo's example, we're trying to think about those desks, or desks in an office, and whether they make a difference. So when you go off and you say that you would like to analyze lighting, okay, super. I'm still going to go ahead and kind of say that, or at least for the purposes of the sunlight, use the daylighting values here as though it was the lead analysis. But I can come over to this little gear icon and switch over here. The notion over here of whether to override the lighting scheme, if you say override, then it's going to override it per the lead test, basically turn off your interior lights. If you uncheck it, it's going to use your lighting scheme. Okay, so it's the logic's a little bit backwards. In the same sense, a little bit further down here, it's turn off visibility for non-permanent model categories. So for a non-permanent thing, which would be a desk, a chair, or it might even be a tree, okay, if you turn off the visibility, then it would disappear, it wouldn't be considered. If you uncheck it, it'll be on, so then it would actually cast a shadow. Okay, so there's this whole thing about whether you're permanent or not, but as we're digging it, we found all these checkbox did very interesting things. sort of pay attention to what's going on back in here. Gustavo, here's that last one in terms of exporting raw analysis data. If you turn that on, it's typically off. Then when you say report, it'll spew out an Excel spreadsheet full of all the values, and you can do whatever you want to with that. But if it's turned off, then the report button doesn't do anything.
That's what's happening. Yeah, I was clicking on it and it
wouldn't do anything. We were clicking this button, they're like, nothing's happening. Okay, so that's what's going on there. But daylighting tool, fantastic in terms of the power that's built into there. It's just you have to sort of, it's kind of finicky, so you have to sort of really work with it and sometimes adjust the settings to really get the results. But in general, you know, for our buildings, you know, do we care that you're getting like LEED 3 points or 2 points? It's not an absolute requirement. It's a good goal to kind of like focus your energy. Okay, but you're going to decide for yourself whether that's an important design consideration relative to all the other design considerations. Because you might have other mitigating factors that say that, hey, you know, for whatever reason, like Gustavo's working on an existing historical building, it may be hard to preserve the historic facade and get the LEED daylighting. It's just kind of tricky to get both those things to happen. Okay, so that's daylighting. But go ahead, and I think most people started playing around with that. But that's just sort of one side of the envelope, and I want to sort of encourage us to think about the other side too. So, actually, before I go on, any sort of general questions about daylighting? In general, you just kind of play with it, and then like we start fussing around with the different things that work and don't work. And for the most part, it kind of does what it's supposed to. Definitely known to be finicky, though. Okay. Questions? Okay. Then let us go ahead and talk about energy. As we think about energy and how Revit models energy, the important things to sort of start out with are always keep in mind that it's going to give you numbers. It'll go through and compute all sorts of numbers, and over 30 years it'll tell you that, oh, this building is going to take $33,586,793.25. It'll give you a number like that. And, you know, it's not going to be that number. It's not, what did I say? It's not necessarily good in terms of providing you accurate estimates. It is good, however, in giving you comparative data. The models are accurate in that if you give it very good assumptions and you model very carefully, it'll produce very reliable, kind of consistently repeatable answers, okay? But it's only as good as your assumptions. So a lot of people will do research and they'll tell you when we do energy modeling, oh, even for like the Y2E2 building, you know, the actual use pattern and what was modeled are like by a factor of two. You know, it's just off. And you wonder why that is. And it's because when they modeled the building, they didn't think that I was gonna leave my windows open or people would be leaving the doors hanging open or all these computers would be in here. They didn't sort of factor all those things in. You know, so models are almost inherently inaccurate because they're just never a true model of the reality. Okay, so as we do this modeling, never get all hung up on that precise number. Don't go betting money on it. But comparatively, if I look at putting all the windows on the south or putting all the windows on the east, given the same set of flawed assumptions, it'll give me a comparative analysis, which is accurate in terms of which is the better way to go. So approach it that way. Realize that as we're doing our modeling, it's going to think about basically a big box where it's going to take your building and sort of model it as a series of surfaces, and then there's going to be thermal properties associated with each of those surfaces. We're going to talk about those in just a second. Think about really what your goal is. Typically, we're trying to moderate things so we always stay within whatever is considered to be the thermal comfort range. For a conditioned space. If you have open air spaces, we make them unconditioned and then they essentially drop out of the analysis. Okay. You have all sorts of boundary conditions. That's really how things are on the outside, the sun and the temperature and things about the climate. The internal conditions are things like the people, the equipment, the lighting. We found even in 220A that we can make a very big difference in our analysis just by changing our assumptions about the spaces, and that determined how many people were in there, and that led to a very different energy use profile. The more accurate, the better. And then finally, it's going to model some energy flows. And really, the big energy flows that you tend to think about are either conduction, radiation, or even re-radiation. And let's talk about which of those are. Actually, I'm talking about it right below. Building envelopes really have all the elements in your building envelope. That is your walls, your windows, your floor, your roof, all those things that separate from the outside. There's really three big categories of like kind of energy flows or energy considerations that are sort of in there. The first one, which is the one that we think about probably the most heavily, is probably the easiest to understand, is the idea of how energy flows through something. And when we're talking about, you know, conduction or resistance, we're really talking about the inverse of the same number. It's really either you're conducting or you're resisting. For whatever reason, when we talk about walls, we often talk about them resisting, so we give them an R value. When we talk about windows, we often talk about their conduction. But it's really, it's one, C equals 1 over R, R equals 1 over C. They're just two inverses of each other. Okay, so in terms of thinking about R values, a couple of different things to sort of know. Like one is just how are R values determined, and there's even a handout kind of hanging out there in coursework for you to go ahead and download. In terms of R values, I found a really nice example, although I know in Gill's class they talk about this quite a bit. Let me go over to thermal transfer, my little R values handout. And basically it works like this. There's some difference in temperature between what's happening on the inside and what's happening on the outside. We're going to try to basically make up that difference, or we're going to head in the direction. If it's hotter on the outside, it's going to basically try to, you know, normalize with what's going on the inside. So the heat will try to come through the walls to the inside. If it's hotter on the inside, it'll try to flow out. But they'll try to normalize. And what's resisting that, in terms of that delta T, is you have some sort of resistance value. And the way resistances work is, if you think about the layers of any wall, each of the different materials that make up the layer have a certain ability to resist or pass heat through. Typically, that's a linear relationship, so that the more inches of the material, you have a linear relationship to how much resistance it provides. So for insulation, for example, if I say R19 insulation, bad insulation, is about a value of 18, I know that, that's probably about 5 inches worth of insulation right there. If I switched on down to a single inch, it would probably be more about a value of R4. If I had 2 inches, it'd be around R8. 3 inches would be about R12. And that's the way we typically work. So we think about the number of inches and the thermal resistance or conductivity of all those materials. So as you think about that, all the sorts of different materials have different R values per inch and then sort of a combined R value. So for like gypsum drywall right now, per inch it's about 0.9, then based on whether it's 3/8, half inch, or 5/8, we sort of get more R. Okay. We often sort of think about it in terms of individual materials. We also start to think in terms of different assemblies, because what tends to happen is that in most walls, it's not strictly uniformly a single material. We'll have a combination. Like this is a typical wood frame stud wall. We have some insulation in most of the area. If it's a 16-inch stud wall, it'll be 14.5 inches worth of insulation. Then we'll have an inch and a half over here, which is the wood framing. And to actually come up with the total value through the wall, what we do is we sort of think about the path through the insulated side. We think about the path going through the wood framing, and then we factor them together in that 1.5 to 14.5 ratio. Okay, so it's all just a weighted average of those things. And that systematic, you know, that works pretty well in terms of what's going on. As you think about this assembly right here, do you have a sense, do you think the air or the heat passes better through or passes more quickly through the insulation or through the wood framing? Brittany's guessing. It is. It passes much more quickly through there. And this is one of the big issues we've really gotten into. If you start looking at the whole notion of passive house design, which is very popular in Europe, we get into trying to break the framing, because what this path does is it creates a weak link in our system. It's considered like a thermal bridge between the inside and the outside. So we've gotten into, as opposed to doing single walls, having two walls where the framing is offset, so that we don't have a direct thermal connection between the inside and the outside. So you can picture if, as opposed to doing the insulation this way, if I took the framing and I put a smaller member here, and then I offset a member here, and then I put a smaller member here, okay, and then I filled all that with insulation. We're going to get a better performance because there's no weak link in the process, or at least there's some insulation throughout the process. So a lot of what we do now in terms of design is we try to put thermal breaks. We just try to prevent that bridging. Okay. But as we go through and try to model something like this in Revit, here's how it sort of plays out. If you go back over to Revit for any wall, that we have here in my walls, now, for my walls, I have a generic wall in Gustavo's building. The wall in this building right now, which we designed more recently at daylighting, doesn't really have much R value to it, doesn't have much resistance because there aren't materials associated with it. Let's go ahead and we'll switch over to one of the other buildings. I'll do one of these ones where the light slots were or something like that. Go zooming on in here. You see, this building's actually made up of a kind of a sandwich of several different layers of things. And the way the R values get computed is you choose the wall assembly. In that wall assembly, you can see it has a combined R value of 54. That's kind of the value for this entire assembly. But how it is computed is we look at the different materials. And for each of those different materials, we have a number of inches of the material, and we have kind of a thick, thermal property for that material, it just multiplies it all together. So if I want to change the properties of this, what I can do is, for example, if I want to change kind of the thermal properties of this metal stud layer, I can go to the thermal properties and see that it has thermal conductivity, it has a density, it has a gas viscosity, a compressibility, it has all these different properties, but that notion of the thermal conductivity is determining like how effective it is to add additional inches. So if I, for example, change that from 6 inches to 8 inches, you'll see the R value of the total wall changes. So thermal conductance is probably the most common thing we think about because we're all sort of got trained to think about that heat flows through surfaces and we're used to trying to think about how to resist that. Now, as you think about these different sort of like surfaces, a very interesting material that we often don't think about very much is air. So the question is air a good insulator? Henry says yes. Henry probably has experience. Well, why is air a good insulator? How do you know air is a good insulator? Give me an example of where air is being used as a good insulated material.
Between two gloves, you have double glazed.
Very good. Very good. Henry knows quite correctly that if we're thinking about windows, and we were going to go and contrast a half inch of solid glass versus 2/4 inch pieces of glass with a layer of like a half inch of air in there or something, that you get much better performance by putting that little bit of air in there. Okay. The air actually creates is basically a thermal break between the inside and the outside that's not very conductive. Okay, so it's very effective to put air in there. So it sounds kind of strange, but even in our wall assemblies, sometimes if you just go ahead and put an air gap of 1 or 2 inches of air between the structural materials and the finished materials, that can be quite okay in terms of providing insulation. Now, most of you also notice this sort of in the way you dress and all that kind of stuff. The whole notion of layering and all this stuff. Some of what's going on in here is there's air kind of trapped in here, and that's actually pretty insulative. So as opposed to being exposed to the elements where all the heat gets sort of blown away, kind of trapping that heat, I'm sort of warming the air inside my sweatshirt and kind of giving myself a little insulative blanket of air. Okay, and that's then sort of separated by the sweatshirt on the outside. But air is really actually a pretty good insulator. So never neglect the air. Then in terms of how good the air is, let's take a look. If I go zipping on down in here, where'd my air go? I actually saw it in here somewhere. An air space of like 1/2 inch is actually equivalent to an R value of 2. Okay, an airspace of 1.25 inch is about 1.69. 3/4 is like an R value of 2. Now that's actually kind of interesting. A lot of windows only have an R value of 1 or 2. So adding that airspace makes a very large difference in terms of what's going on. So don't neglect air. Air is kind of a good thing for you. If you prevent it, if you're just sort of exposed to the outside and it's cold air out there, you know, then you're not really getting that effect. But if you can kind of trap it in a sandwich, then it actually does sort of very good things. So just air or heat flowing through surfaces is really probably the most, you know, direct one that we spend a lot of time thinking about. That's conductance. Realize that conductance sort of works not only for the walls, it affects the roof. So the roof in its own way has an R value based on the materials that are there. The floor has an R value to it. So we did this a lot last time in 220A. If you start putting a little bit of insulation under the concrete, that actually does a nice effect of sort of stopping heat from flowing down into the ground. We often say we think of the ground as being pretty inert, but when it comes right down to it, if we have a very tight building and it's using energy very effectively, that small difference between the 55 degree earth or 60 degree earth and the temperature we're trying to maintain is enough that heat is flowing through the slab. So often we'll put 2 or 3 inches of insulation under the slab, and that'll be a recommendation in a lot of house designs. Yeah.
For the air between glass?
Yes.
Are there any cases where like it's left open, so air can leave?
Is that you can still have a vented curtain wall or something like that. Okay. And that's still okay. It's still better than, even if the air is moving, what's going to happen to any of the air that's temporarily trapped in there will be an intermediate temperature between the inside and the outside. So you'll still get some benefit from it. Okay, as opposed to being completely trapped in there. But you'll still get it. It's still better than being on the outside. Which is why even in like double wall buildings, you have this whole thing where, oh, you look at new buildings like the Shanghai Tower, there's an inner glass wall, there's an outer glass wall, and the idea that none of the interior conditioned spaces are directly against the outside wall, you know, really, you know, kind of creates a nice insulative barrier. Let me go ahead and show you that. So this is actually true in a lot of buildings in Europe. We don't do it so much in the US, but let me say Shanghai Tower. Double skin. See if I can find a nice picture of what's going on here. Actually, you can almost sort of see it here. What's going on is you have the inner skin, which is the conditioned space. You have this outer skin, which is really protecting us from the elements. And that in-between space, it's not quite outside, it's not quite inside, but it's actually like a big thermal layer of air that's just kind of protecting the building, actually increasing the performance of the building quite a bit.
So it looks like it's a used, like it's like a, some
yeah.
sort of walkway or...
What they do is they actually use that space productively as a series of sky gardens with trees and like parks at the intermediate levels of the building.
So that being mechanically cold?
In this case, no. It's probably, I think that's all just naturally ventilated on the outside. It's not sealed, okay? I think the panels actually have a little bit of a gap in them, so air comes through, but it's still better than just the wind whipping through. It's mostly protected, okay? But really, in this case, the thermal boundary is that inner wall, okay? And then you get to this outer boundary, which is somewhere between. The heat on the inside is keeping it warm enough that it's pretty good, but we're not actually conditioning it. There may be some ventilation going through. Okay, but it's kind of an interstitial space, you'd say. Okay, and that's sort of a very kind of common strategy. There you sort of see it being built in there. You have the inner wall, you have the outer wall. And double skin facades are definitely something to look at as you think about these things. Okay, now windows have thermal conductive properties, just so you don't forget about them. You can go ahead and choose the window. If you choose the window, each of the different windows, its thermal properties are typically represented in terms of the glazing style. So you see for a plain old 1/8 inch Pilkington glass window, which is kind of, oh, that's Brandex. That's the standard window that's been put around for so long. It has a thermal conductive value or thermal resistance value about 1.5. Where if I go to, even 1/8 inch Pilkington, single glazing, single glass pane, and unsealed openable frames, single glass with a quarter inch cavity. Okay. That didn't seem like a change very much. Let me go to a slightly bigger double glazing, quarter inch. Okay, get it to a value of like 2.8 or something like that. So we can make the windows a little bit better. We could have multiple layers. Some people say, oh, well, if I could put two layers in there, what if I put three layers in? And you can put four layers in, and the window's starting to get very expensive. There's a trade-off in there. In fact, that little insight tool will help you figure out, it'll run it under those different scenarios and figure out how many layers of glazing are effective. Typically, that's not the most effective thing to do. Because, you know, although the windows are substantially worse off than the walls or the roof, that's typically not the biggest source of heat or kind of energy loads that we're getting into. Often it has more to do with the sun and the energy that's coming into the sun than actually the heat sort of radiating in and out. Kind of depends. I say that here in Palo Alto because we have that moderate temperature. If I was in Dubai, I'd have a much bigger kind of conduction problem because the temperature differential between inside and outside is much better, or much bigger. But we can always go through and kind of model our conductive surfaces. So in your envelope, think about your conduction. Even over here for the skylight even has thermal properties. So don't forget about anything, because what'll happen in the end is it'll always find the weakest link. That's interesting. 3/8 inch cooking glass is 0.84, so I've tripled the thickness of the glass and I haven't really changed the R value very much. Okay. Whereas adding a little bit of double glazing makes a much bigger difference. Double glazing, 1/8 inch, and get it up to 2.8 or something like that. So much less glass, but much better thermal performance because I'm putting that in. Actually, this window I'm choosing is even a little bit better. It has something called low E glass, and we'll talk about that now, because that's the second force you have to worry about. Okay, so conduction, most people get conduction. Conduction's sort of, that's the part everyone sort of understands, and the big issue is there, put good insulators in there, and watch out to make sure you don't have thermal bridges. You always try to look for thermal bricks. And again, if you look at all that passive house stuff that people are talking about now, we'll spend a lot of time talking about how to put the breaks in. It's all about the thermal breaks, so you don't have these paths where heat's kind of leaking out. The next type of heat flow that you want to think about is radiation, and radiation absorption in particular. And let's talk about where this is coming from. Okay, we happen to have a very big radiant source of energy, which graces us with its presence every day. Hopefully continuing to do that, known as the sun, and that just puts out an incredible amount of energy. So beyond just heating up the air that we're all sort of enjoying, okay, there's all this energy that comes in just as radiant energy. So it's not actually heating up the air, it's actually just radiating right into the surface and we absorb it, okay? And you know about this kind of energy because if you have ever tried tiptoeing across an asphalt parking lot in the middle of summer, you know, and felt the heat coming off something like that, or if you've climbed into your car on a summer afternoon and slid across those black leather seats, okay, you know what the effect of radiant energy. Radiant energy is very, very strong. It's why, even on a cool day, you know, I'll go sit in front of the south-facing window, even though conductively there may be a lot of heat losing through there, I'm absorbing all that radiant energy. It just feels good. It feels nice inside to kind of feel that radiant energy right on your skin surface. Okay, so radiation's the other way we tend to get energy. Now, radiation, you don't sort of feel it, it's absorbed. So we have to absorb it into something. And here's where you typically absorb it. Okay, we'll go back over to our little building over here. Think about all these different surfaces. Each of these different surfaces has something called an absorption. And it's another one of the little properties in here. We don't think about it very much. There's thermal, there's heat transfer coefficient, there's absorptance right there. Okay, that's basically what portion of the energy it's gonna suck in. Okay, so things that are very good at absorbing energy are things like concrete. They tend to absorb pretty well. Anything that's sort of black tends to absorb because it's very affected on by color. Anything that has a dark color will try to absorb the energy. If you have a light color, it'll tend to radiate the energy. So if I'm wandering through the desert and there's no water around and I'm trying to keep myself cool, as tempting as it is to strip off everything and just go wandering and enjoy the breeze, we're actually better off keeping some sort of, white sheet-like substance around us to go through and just reflect all that energy so it's not absorbing into my skin. It'll actually be much more comfortable. So white tends to be a good color for reflecting. It reflects the most light. Black tends to absorb the most. Okay, how that plays in most of our buildings is, let me kind of pop this back out again. Put one in here. I thought I put a curtain wall in here. Maybe I didn't put it in that one. What building was I looking at? The shed skylight? Try that. There we go. In this sort of scenario, we have all that glass. That glass is awful. You know, realize that its R value is so much less than the walls, so we must really be losing out. But all that concrete behind the glass is actually absorbing all that energy. Okay, so there's a trade-off in there. Same thing with the roof. That skylight, that energy is going to come on down through there. If we provide surfaces for it to be absorbed into, we're going to be in good shape. So let's think about absorption. If you are trying to heat your building, absorption sounds like a good thing. If you are trying to cool your building, absorption sounds like an awful thing because you don't want to get all that energy in there. And that's what shading is all about. When we start talking about all the shading, what we're trying to do is during the cooling months, just keep the heat or keep the sunlight from hitting the inside where it'll be absorbed. It's okay that it hits the outside, it hits the screen out there because we're not worrying about that air, it's outside the building. We're just trying to keep it from being absorbed inside the building where it'll be re-radiated. Okay, now let's talk about this big old brick wall. Does that brick wall absorb energy? Yeah, it absorbs energy too. All walls sort of do, just kind of depends on the materials. If I coat a building in stucco or concrete, it'll absorb a lot. If I coat something in wooden shingles, it doesn't absorb so much. Wood is much more insulative, it doesn't absorb very much. So we also get it through the walls. The roof also absorbs, and this is something you'll hear an awful lot about. You hear about cool roofs, and what's the difference between a cool roof and a normal roof? It's just the color. It's like it's really simple. If you make it all white, it'll reflect a lot of light, so it just won't absorb as much. Okay, so there's not a lot of magic to it. Sort of things that are very bright reflect it, they absorb a lot less. And also, there's some difference in terms of the surface, very shiny surfaces versus very rough surfaces. But in general, there's this whole notion of absorbing, okay? And that's kind of the second piece of it. So when we talk about cool roofs, color, darker colors are going to absorb a lot of energy. In general, brighter colors are not. So even in terms of your buildings, if I cover my building in a whole lot of white stucco versus a whole lot of dark black stucco, it'll make some sort of difference. Okay, finally, the third force we want to talk about, which is ever so important, is thermal mass. And this is the one that's sort of confused, a little bit confusing, because it's probably actually one of the biggest impacts. Think about thermal mass as really creating a place to store the energy that is absorbed. Okay, so some materials have very high thermal mass, other materials have very low thermal mass. Concrete has a very high thermal mass. Earth has a very high thermal mass. Okay, things like light frame metal stud walls don't, because although they may get hot very quickly, okay, it doesn't hold that heat. It radiates away very quickly too. Whereas concrete and things that have high thermal mass store it and re-radiate it very slowly. And that's why we like concrete floors and concrete walls, is because they can heat up all day long. They sort of slowly heat up. They're always lagging, and then after it gets cool outside, they slowly cool down. So all that heat which was stored inside slowly but surely radiates into the building. Okay, or radiates back in. So where that shows up in Revit, in the same sort of sense, if I go through and choose the concrete or something like that, one of its properties is the thermal mass. Okay, the more thermal mass you have, the better you are going to be about storing and re-radiating heat, the less, okay, the less good you're going to be about doing something like that. So even like the concrete's very good, the concrete may not be the most efficient insulator. The thermal resistance is very small, but it has really good thermal mass. My roof, on the other hand, right now, what's going on there? It is a very good insulator, but has very little thermal mass. Okay, and the key is to balance these three things relative to each other. Okay, an interesting place to think about where they balance is, however, green roofs. Let's talk about green roofs for just a second. We all talk about green roofs. Everyone, almost everyone has come up with some sort of scheme that involves putting some sort of green roof on. So what is the advantage of green roofs? Let's talk about that. Why do we put green roofs on buildings?
It's also a form of a cool roof.
It is a form of a cool roof. It does keep the direct sunlight off. That's actually very good. It's good for keeping the radiation off because basically the earth and the grass and all that is going to keep it from radiating and being absorbed in the roof. So it's part of a cooling. How's it from an insulative side effect?
Quite good, right?
Actually, we're going to find, there's been a lot of research into this, it's really not that great as an insulator. And here's why. Earth is a pretty good insulator. Okay, that's super. You know, what's one of the most conductive materials? Yeah, air is actually pretty conductive in terms of its, well, it can be insulative, you can transfer heat with it. Yeah, water turns out to be a very thermally conductive sort of material. So the problem with green roofs is they're often kind of wet. So you're not actually getting the value of all the earth as an insulative material. It turns out the R value you add through a green roof is actually pretty small. And there's a lot of research looking into existing green roofs, and there's a report about kind of green roofs and how they create them, what the effects are. And basically it comes out that the R value change is actually really sort of minimal. There's all sorts of things why the values are kind of good, but it's not typically about the R value. Okay. Where it turns out that roofs tend to be very, very good has to do with something like this. Yeah, the earth is actually pretty good at absorbing that radiation, okay, but in a typical roof sort of scenario, we heat up during the sun day, but we cool off rapidly at night, it's not so good. In a cool roof, it doesn't heat up as much, okay, but it still cools off a whole lot at night. But in a green roof, here's what happens. It doesn't heat up very much, but all that earth is basically a giant thermal mass battery that is basically storing that heat through the day. So at night, it slowly re-radiates that back out and kind of gently kind of provides some sort of a blanket of heating or something like that. So when you're thinking about green roofs, they have all sorts of fantastic benefits in terms of, oh, just green spaces and being nice spaces to sort of not have a lot of rooftops that are just cluttered with equipment, providing nice, usable living spaces. But you're thinking about them thermally. Yeah, they're good in a number of ways, but you'll find out they don't add that much in terms of insulative value. It's really more of a thermal mass effect. So just watch out for that. Yes?
If they don't have much insulative value, how do they... still heats up, but not during the day later?
Well, the effect is... Okay. What they're doing is, it's not a conductive kind of blocker. It's more that, if you think about the radiation is being absorbed by the earth as opposed to being absorbed by the roof. It's being absorbed by the earth rather than the roof surface, and then it's being stored in the earth. So as a battery, then it releases it later at night. So it kind of cuts out on the amount of radiation you get, and it also sort of stores it and releases the heat in a more moderated way.
So it's good if you have a drop in temperature at night.
Oh yeah.
That's when it's good.
Oh, definitely. Because, you know, think of it as basically being a big battery. It's going to be absorbing a lot of energy during the day. It's going to radiate it out at night. Okay, which typically works pretty well for a whole strategy of needing to heat at night. Yeah, versus trying to keep it cool during the day.
Yeah.
So it kind of, it's of the three different things, not necessarily so good on conductance, but great in terms of being a thermal radiant barrier, okay, and also as a thermal mass.
So it's it does the opposite of what is done here in Y2E2.
In what sense? Oh, in terms of...
You're taking the hot air out?
At night. Oh, yes.
And that's what's bringing hot, putting hot air in.
Exactly. Well, it would be. Okay, but that's because of our climate here. We don't need that much heat.
Yeah.
Like, here, in our building, if you think about the analysis, we as people are generating enough heat during the day that, you know, basically we have the problem. We have to get rid of the heat at night. Okay, whereas if we had another building where we didn't have so much heat to work with, we want to sort of store the heat. Yeah, so exactly. It has to work into your overall strategy, which gets to your climate and everything. Basically, you got to figure out, do you have a heating problem or do you have a cooling problem? Or, you know, when do you have those at different times of the day? And how your combination of systems can accommodate all those different things, summer months versus winter months, night versus day. So very interesting and cool. Okay, so if we pop back over to just sort of thinking about the tools. That's the big idea, is that you have these different forces there at work. You need to, in your models, go through and encode the correct thermal resistance, kind of put the right materials in there, layer them to kind of get the right sort of kind of thermal properties working for you. But then, from a Revit standpoint, we're just basically going to go through and model all those things as a series of different kind of values on different surfaces, and we're going to figure out how much heat is flowing in and how much heat is flowing out. Now, in terms of working with that, over here, we have played around with different sorts of building analyses in the past. Let me see if I have any kind of even hanging around in here. Still, oh, it won't be for this building, but we'll show the types of things that happen. If I go through and say analyze, and I say that I want to go through and do an energy analysis, we have some energy settings over here. At a high level, we set things like the location, we set the building type, we say we're going to use the building elements for the analysis. We're going to actually go through and use the thermal properties. If you want to use the thermal properties, you have to turn that on. If you don't say turn on and use the thermal properties, it'll use some high-level defaults, okay, for what it thinks approximate values are for the walls and roofs. There's some conceptual constructions that'll kick in there. If you've done the time, taken the time to go ahead and put in thermal properties, go ahead and turn that on. It'll use your R values as opposed to the R values that are sort of assumed by default. Okay, and then in the end, oh, in terms of the defaults, they're under here, the conceptual construction. So they have all sorts of different properties that are kind of approximate for what you want. When we say okay to all these things, super, we go ahead and we generate an energy model. Actually, it's kind of an interesting one. When you say create an energy model, this is something that showed up in Revit 2016. It didn't used to be here. This is the energy model. You can sort of see what's going on is that is those different surfaces. It's taken everything you've done about your building and reduced it to a bunch of single surfaces with different properties. So this is how the energy analysis actually works. You go through and say that you want to run the analysis. Okay, and then ultimately it gives you some reports. Reports that look like this. Let's see if I can find one that actually looks pretty good. A building I worked on with Henry the other day. For the building, it'll report things like the energy use intensity. It'll also start to show us really, both in terms of heating and cooling, what sort of loads are really the biggest issues right now. Actually, this wasn't a very good building because we didn't put new windows in that one. Let me go to this building instead. In this building, you can start to see, in terms of the reports, let's just kind of take a look at it briefly. In terms of the heating loads, you will see that for heat is flowing out. The biggest bar you see right now is this red bar, window conductive. What that's telling me is of all the different things, your conductance values for the windows are the biggest things that would have an impact on reducing the heating load. So I might go ahead and look at my curtain walls of my windows and up the R values, or lower the conductance values. Next up, you can see the effect of window solar. It's actually not so bad. It's a slightly orange bar. Everything's just sort of relative. So the idea is these charts just tell you about really what's going to generate your heating loads and your cooling loads. Okay. Over here, in terms of the cooling, here you start to see that of all the different bars, the biggest one is this orange bar, window solar. What that's telling us is that for the windows, the solar coefficients, the solar heat gain that's allowed through, or the shading through the windows, would probably make the biggest difference in terms of actually being able to make a change in the building's performance. So you can go ahead and look at it this way, or if you prefer, use this Insight tool. What Insight tool is good for is it basically goes through and creates a whole series of different sliding bar graphs. I showed it at the end of class one day, where for each of the different values, like the wall values, it'll show you what the impact of having an R19 wall, an R30 wall is, an R60 wall. So you can start to just get a sensitivity to really what are the things that are going to make the biggest difference. Okay, so just be thinking about how to use some of those thermal properties together. Okay, so I'll go ahead and stop there on the thermal stuff right now. For the most part, a lot of us have played around with some of the thermal modeling in 220A or in some other classes, but any questions in general? Is there anything you'd like to think see modeled? Like sometimes you'd like me to model a green roof or anything you'd like to see modeled in Revit relative to that? So just, in any sort of sample building, are there any sort of unique energy features that you're thinking about on your building that you're sort of wondering about how it might appear in a Revit model? Henry, what you got?
Now that you mentioned the China example with the two glass facades with the interstitial space in between.
Yes.
Like, just by laying it out that way, the energy analysis understands
what's happening. Well, what it'll be is, okay, so in that, if you were kind of doing a Shanghai Tower sort of example, I'd do something like this. I have my, that's my curtain wall, my existing curtain wall right now. Let me go ahead, I'll do another curtain wall on the outside. So I'll again do storefront, I'll just go up to level 2. And I'm gonna go up like this, leave some sort of barrier there. Again, that's that insulative air barrier. So I'll pop it in like that. Okay, the have to go put a roof on it, that's kind of okay. Actually, you wouldn't have to, but then it would actually be sort of silly in terms of this going on. So what I'll do is go back up to the roof and sort of pull that out a little bit.
If it's actually an open air, the roof would be...
It's, you gotta think about whether you want it to be completely open at the top or whether we're gonna sort of model gaps in the surface. Like in the glass surface, which is probably kind of closer to what you have in that double skin facade. But then the way to ultimately sort of make sure you model this is it won't be in the building elements, it'll be when we do the spaces. Remember, there's spaces, and those are the ones where you start to have the ability that we can say, let's go ahead and analyze, I'll put some spaces in here. And this space will now start to have its own set of properties. So this space that I just put in there, see if I can grab it again. That now has the ability to say that it is unconditioned. Or you can say that it's vented. Well, no, unconditioned would be better for her. Or naturally vented might be the best way to think about it. Because what's going to happen there is the only thing that's going to go on is like natural air is going to flow through it.
So now here, so you have a 1 meter air gap?
Here it's, yeah, something like that, yeah. Now, in the Shanghai building, it's much bigger because they actually put a park space out there. But just that difference between the interior part being conditioned, the exterior being unconditioned, and that gap, which is still in skin condition, but sort of provides this insulative layer of air, okay, it'll actually improve your performance. So double skin facades are pretty cool. Another random thing people like to model is if you're thinking about doing a green roof, green roofs are really just a series of layers. There's really not a whole lot to them. If you go back to, there's the handout on green roofs, it'll show you kind of the typical construction. So think about it, it has a roof deck, it has some protection board, a waterproof membrane, some insulation. That's all pretty typical stuff for the standard roof. But then it has this drainage layer. You don't want like water just building up in there and like a giant, you know, sponge. You want to drain it out somewhere. So you have a layer of drainage, some filter fabric to keep the earth away, and then the plants on top of that. So roughly, and again, we get very precise about this, you'll go through here and say, if I'm going to duplicate that and I'm going to call it my green roof, let's go ahead and add in some more layers. So on top of this kind of EDPM, that's the air layer of the waterproofing, I might go through and add in, oh, like an air layer of some type. Maybe 2 inches of that. Then on top of that, I'm gonna add in, oh, some sort of, it's gonna be a, sort of like a finish layer out here. This is gonna be earth. Okay, and oh, what'll that be? I'll make it like a foot of earth, something like that. Oops, wrong spot there. And then finally, you might go through and put a little bit of planting layer on top of that still. See if I have any plantings out here. I don't know if I do. I'll just put sand on there. I should make a planting material, but I won't do it right now. And that'll be relatively thin. So I have this new assembly. Notice the earth layer really didn't add very much. 1 foot, 1 foot six. It doesn't change the earth value very much at all. Okay, but what you do have to watch out when you do something like this, row four, what's happening there? I need to sort of change my layering. See if it'll do that. I think that's layer three. So hang on. We gotta do this. I'll put that at the finish one. Five, four. Oh, I'm going the wrong way. Three. Thing to watch out for relative to these green roofs though is, remember, you have to put a little of typically a boundary around the outside just to kind of keep all that earth from spilling off. So what you typically will end up doing is putting some sort of a small wall, okay, just around the outside edges. Not that. Might go up to level two. And at the edge of the roof, I'll put some sort of little wall. Oh, let's say it's only going to go up about 2 feet or something like that. Not a storefront wall. Let's make it a generic wall for now. So just remember to cap it off. Same thing if you're kind of building planters around a terrace or something like that. As you're working on these sorts of things, it's an interesting thing about whether it's better to go ahead and build different types of roofs or just sort of add the green roof as a separate layer on top of the other roofs. I actually sort of like to model it that way, but it sort of prefers us to break it up into separate sections. But so if you're playing with green roofs, like let's talk about it when it comes time to do the detailed Revit modeling of what's going on there. Okay. So hopefully that's enough to get going in terms of the different facade surfaces. Ultimately, all this is going to matter when it all for not only kind of a high-level energy analysis, but as we start getting into thinking about your building systems and the loads that are being generated for your building systems, you know, think about sizing the size of the heating and cooling equipment. That'll all sort of be dependent on whatever you put in there as the thermal properties of the outside walls. Okay, kind of make sense? Beauty. Okay, then let me do this. I'm gonna shift gears ever so briefly here at the end. See, thinking about some of those thermal properties, and we'll talk about that, just to thinking about our structure. And just in terms of the structure, what I wanna do is just get you thinking about how your structure relates to the skin of your building. Because as we've been looking at most of the building so far, we've been thinking about where the walls are, but we haven't paid very much attention to yet where columns might be, where walls that might support the roof would be, and just, you know, where all the different things that are kind of supporting all the gravity loads are. So let's just kind of give you a couple ideas of how this could work. In many cases, you can go through and just use walls as not only the skin of the building, but also providing the structural support. And in most houses, when we think about wood frame walls, they are doing that. They're not only sort of providing an outside thermal barrier, but they're also supporting the roof and stuff like that. And we typically do that on very small scale structures, but as you start thinking about bigger structures, it makes sense to separate those two functions, to really think about the skeletal support for the structure to be independent of the skin. Okay, so they could really operate independently. In terms of different ways of approaching it, there are all sorts of buildings that look like this, where the structure may not be visible from the outside. The structure is almost inside the skin. It's all kind of hanging around in there. And if we go into any of those buildings, what you tend to see is that there's a series of structural columns and things inside that skin, but they don't want that visible on the outside. They want the skin to be very sleek and smooth and really convey some sort of architectural message. So one is just this whole notion of keeping the structure on the inside. This is the Clark Center here on campus. The Clark Center is actually really cool. It's almost like just big glass walls. It's like a big goldfish bowl or something like that over there. But if you stand there in the courtyard, you can see through the glass and you can see the columns coming down inside the space. And that's quite okay. A lot of times we get all flustered. Oh, I don't want columns in the middle of my open space. But that actually happens more often than you think. And it can be okay. It's not necessarily a huge distraction. Somehow columns provide a nice rhythm that's kind of nice. Here in the Disney Hall, which is an inspiration to some of us, you again can't really see the structure. It's all hidden inside of that skin. Another strategy is to put the structure on the outside. So this is a building that used to be in Kansas City, Kemper Arena. You can very clearly see the exterior structure there. There's giant mega trusses on the outside of the building. You can't miss where the structure is there. Okay, it's one of the architectural features. This is the Hong Kong Bank Building. Okay, again, the structure is sort of very visible on the outside. Another strategy, though, is to put the structure in line with the walls. So if you're over at Trusteter and you're sitting out at Coho, you're sitting over in kind of the main food concourse, you'll find the glass walls are there, the columns are there, and they're actually in line with each other. The glass walls are sort of wedged in between the columns. In this building, Faneuil Hall, which is in Boston, you can see the structural, they're pilasters here. They're not exactly columns, but they're structural supports, and the windows and the walls are actually sort of wedged in between them. Okay, even here, as you go through and think about like the quad, for the most part, what's happening is the structure is in the wall. It's in line with the wall. It's not really hidden. Although the Stanford Quad has this hidden secret, there's actually kind of an inner concrete shell and all the stones kind of stacked up on the outside because they retrofitted a lot of it for earthquake safety. Is that what they're doing on our little chem too?
Yeah, they have shotcrete walls.
Okay, and then this, the
dowels into the stone.
Yeah, and the stone's just on the outside, kind of really not providing much support. Okay. Here the walls are providing, concrete walls are actually providing little structural support. This is more like a typical wood frame house. And again, the framing of the walls is kind of very much related to what's going on in terms of supporting the roof. So how that plays in to your thinking about your skin, I just want to do something real brief with you. You just kind of think about how those different options can play out, because as you've been placing walls and thinking about that, I'm going to want to start encouraging you to start thinking about where the column lines are, where the structural support lines are, and then always be thinking about where the walls are positioned relative to them. Okay? So to sort of consider something like that, we put out there on the server for you. See if I can find it. Some structural framing examples. I have a concrete, I have a steel, and I have a wood. Any preference for like which material you'd like? Okay, we're ultimately gonna look at all three of them, but you know, what material would you like to start with relative to the whole issue of concrete, but steel or wood?
Concrete.
Concrete? Okay, let's go for concrete. Concrete being a very commonly used material. It's a very humble material, but it's incredibly valuable. What is it? We don't give it as much kind of due. It's sort of got a bad name at some point because concrete was sort of a very inexpensive material, so some people started giving it. It was kind of associated with cheaper construction. But in a lot of places in the world where steel is very, very expensive, concrete is really the predominant method of going through and constructing things. Okay, so this is an example of a concrete frame. It's a very simple little building. We're going to go ahead and model things like this, where we have just a whole series of different concrete columns, concrete beams, and concrete slabs. Okay, as we look at that, we'll sort of talk more about how we go through and frame something about like this. In general, the nice thing about concrete, let me go ahead and draw a section through this, is concrete is sort of forgiving from the standpoint of the way we sort of lay it out in a building modeling sense, in that, go ahead and cut the section through here. As you think about how everything, let me shade this for you, to make it a little bit easier. As you think about how things are laid out, the issue of the beams and the slabs sort of melds together in an interesting way. Very often when we pour the beams and we pour the slabs, if it's a cast-in-place structure, the beams and the slabs actually sort of occupy the same space. So if I come on over here and I zoom on in, actually it looks a little bit different right now. Let me see what the difference is in terms of the materiality, because if it's the same material, it should sort of work out the same. That's just concrete there, concrete cast in place. Let me look at my floor slab here. Did I do the same thing over there? It says concrete cast in place. I'm wondering why it's still sort of grayed out. But you can sort of see in terms of the lines, it's all joining together. It really sort of considers it to be one thing. In fact, maybe I'll do this. Let me try this. I'll say join. Under modify. Do it? No. It's going to mess with me. But in general, when we go through and place beams, we don't worry about offsetting them. We actually just put them right up to the floor level, because we sort of get this like action at the corners where even though it's part of the floor slab, it's actually contributing to the beam depth and stuff like that. So very common in terms of doing something like that. I will contrast that ever so briefly with a steel frame structure, which is a little bit different. With steel frame structures, we have a slightly different problem. What we have to do there is actually just think about the different materials and how they're going to work together. And the reason is, let me zoom on in here. If I go thinking about that steel deck and I think about the beams underneath it, what I can't have is the beams running through the steel deck, so I have to lower everything just to make it below the steel deck. Okay, so as we're modeling, there's a little bit of difference there in terms of how we approach that. But again, not to worry about that too much. We'll talk about that more next time. Let me go back over to a little concrete building, and we'll think about my wall strategy. Okay, so I'm going to go on down to my first floor, and I have oh, these fabulous concrete columns, they're kind of hanging around over here. They're on some column grid lines and stuff like that. The question is, where are you going to put your walls relative to these columns? And this is sort of a really good question because, oh, you could go ahead and approach it in a number of different ways. I could go ahead and put my wall kind of just right on the column line. Let me go ahead and make sure my walls are visible. Hang on. Discipline, let's say coordination. Hang on, that's it. Discipline right there. Coordination. There we go. I could go ahead and put my walls right on that line. The effect of putting my walls right on that line, though, is that I'm going to go through and put my walls after they fit them between the different kind of structural columns, which can be okay, and a lot of buildings will do that. You can see the structural columns, and if that's a brick wall or something like that, it'll be hanging out inside. Maybe I'll just make that a nice brick wall. And a brick on CMU. You can do that. The other way to do it, though, is to think about offsetting things a little bit. And this is what I want you to start thinking about relative to how you're going to lay out your building. The other way to do it, another way, which I would say is a little less common, is to actually go through and put the wall on the inside of the structure. And what is the effect of doing that? It's actually quite okay. It's actually kind of a nice architectural effect often to go through and, let's say, make that coordination. Come back to the corner. So rather than sort of thinking about all those walls kind of being in frame with the concrete, okay, and the concrete sort of poking out that way, to actually have them inset. Often if we have little overhangs at each level, it's sort of a nice architectural effect to do something like that. The nice thing about doing something like that is that if you go ahead and let the kind of frame sort of stand out, something like that, you know, the frame is really quite independent. So if you decide to change that from a brick wall to, for example, a curtain wall or something like that, that's quite okay. Actually, my curtain walls are not visible right now. Okay. You can go ahead and have that interior skin quite independent of what's going on the outside. And again, that's okay. You start paying attention as you go wandering around on campus. How many buildings you see actually have the columns visible from the outside? A lot of the older concrete buildings built in the 60s and 70s actually do. You can sort of see the concrete quite prominent and the skin being very separate. Another way to do it, and the third alternative I want you to consider, is that you could go ahead and have the exterior wall just sort of wrapping the outside of the columns. And let me show you what I mean by that. Typically when I do something like that, I'll take my like brick exterior wall and I'll think about what is the structural core of the wall. In this case, it'll be the CMU, it'll be the concrete masonry units. And what I'll do is go through and place it in this way. I'll say I'm going to place it based by the core exterior. My friends from the 220A will recognize that I always love that place. I will wrap the wall here. I'll do the same sort of thing here. I'll wrap the wall here. I'm going to trim those together. What's happening in this scenario is the structural core of the wall is lining up with the structural skeleton of the building, and the skin is just wrapping around the insides, the outside. So the insulative layers, the finish layer of brick, it's all wrapping around out there. The net effect for you is that you can't really see the structure at all. Okay, but it's not that the whole wall is outside, it's just the finish layers are wrapping the structure. The structural core of the wall typically lines up. And that'll tend to be true whether I do it with this brick and CMU. In our case, we have it a little bit different. Do I have a wall that looks like it? I don't in this file. I'll put one in here. Our building here, for example, has a steel frame where the support for the walls is a metal stud framing system. It's in line with the outside edge of the slab, and then all the stone panels are hanging as a skin on the outside of the structural frame. So just be thinking about, in your own building, are you skeleton in, skeleton out, or skeleton in line? Because you can kind of go either way in terms of doing it, but go ahead and sort of think about doing it intentionally. The reason I sort of show you this, and I want to sort of stress this as you kind of depart for the weekend this time, is that I want you to start thinking about your buildings and as you're putting them in there, not in terms of the walls determining the location of everything, but start thinking in terms of the structure determining the location of everything, and then the walls are just positioned relative to the structure, either a few inches inside, a few inches outside, or right on the structure. Okay? Because in the scheme, even though as we start doing our architectural design and Revit, we typically do it the other way, the hierarchy really works that the structure tends to dominate. And this, like our skeleton, the skeleton really determines what's going on, and the skin just wraps around it, okay, relative to the skeleton. Okay? So we'll leave it there for today. So just be thinking ahead to your buildings as we meet. We'll keep on talking about the architectural features and how that's all laying out. But you'll see pretty soon we're going to start sketching in, you know, are the walls supporting that roof? Are there columns supporting that roof? And if there are columns supporting that roof, are they on the inside, or the outside, or right in line? Cool? Okay, great. Let us adjourn for today.